welcome to the funeral services of Mariana Nancy Crookston Israelson. I am Danny Corbridge, and I am the first counselor in the 10th Ward. I'm honored to conduct this funeral and to celebrate her life. The family prayer has been offered previously by a son-in-law, Stephen Erickson. We'd like to thank our organist, Norma Christensen, for playing the organ, and Sister Rachel Orr for being the chorister here. We'll begin the service by singing hymn number 301, I Am a Child of God, following which an opening prayer by Randy Jones, a son-in-law.
Our Father in heaven, we are thankful to be gathered here today to pay tribute to thy daughter, Mariana Nancy Israelson. We are thankful for our relationship with her as our mother, grandmother, neighbor, friend, and relative. We are thankful for the life that she led, for her love, sacrifice, and talents, and example. We are thankful for thy plan of salvation and our knowledge of it and its eternal nature. And we're so thankful for thy son, Jesus Christ, for his atonement and resurrection that conquered death so that we will all live again. We ask thee for thy spirit to be with us at this meeting and throughout the events of the day, that we will be comforted as we mourn Nancy's passing. We ask thee that through thy spirit we will learn more about and reflect upon thy plan of salvation and the brief roles that this mortal life and death plays, the eternal nature of thy plan. We ask thee that we will learn more about Nancy today and the great life and example that she gave us. And as we reflect on Nancy's good qualities such as faith, determination to follow Jesus Christ and his gospel, the importance of family, and sharing her time and talents so selflessly, we ask thee to help us to follow her example and resolve to better instill these great qualities into our own lives. And we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I thought of Nancy as a good friend, and it's an honor to conduct this meeting. We'll go ahead and follow the program as outlined. First, we will have a life sketch by Laurie Iselson-Ballum, a daughter. Then remembrances by children Bonnie, James, Richard, Eve, Lila, and John. Then, following which will be a musical number by granddaughters Vanessa Ballum, Easter Briggs, Olivia Blair, performing evening prayer from Hansel and Gretel. And then remembrances by Ned, Mark, Laurie, Jean, Doug, and Dwight, followed by which a musical number by Michael Ballum, a son-in-law, Think on Me. And then remarks by a good friend, Joe Fenton, and then I will have remarks and we'll go to that point. So, Laurie.
Marianne and Nancy Crookston Israelson peacefully joined her sweetheart Lyle, surrounded by her family, on June 20th, 2018, at the age of 93. Nancy was a devoted wife, loving mother of 12, grandmother, great-grandmother, and great-great-grandmother to 193, a posterity of 205. Nancy was born in Logan, Utah on August 17, 1924 to Glenna Ballantyne and Robert Burns' coach, Crookston. When she was two, she moved to a small fruit and chicken farm in North Logan. Except for a few years during World War II, North Logan would always, by choice, be her home. For Nancy, growing up there was paradise with a variety of fruit trees and animals, horses to ride, kittens and puppies to love, and thousands of eggs to gather. Nancy appreciated the many talents of her mother, her ability to create beauty from ordinary things, her gift of painting, music, literature, and graciousness, all of which she inherited and cultivated throughout her life. From her father, she learned discipline as she watched him as an athlete and coach, and gentleness and kindness as he loved and nurtured his wife. Nancy always had a passion for learning and excelled at North Logan Elementary School, a four-room school of eight grades. She began high school at South Cache High in Hiram, transferring her junior year to Logan High, where her dad was coach. Here she became involved in many activities, including drama, rifle team, and student body offices. It wasn't long before Lyle Israelson, who lived just two doors down, noticed the dark-haired beauty, staked his claim, and began courting her. Their plans were interrupted when Pearl Harbor was bombed and Lyle enlisted in the Navy. Nancy enlisted at USAC as an art major, later to become Utah State. They determined to wait until after the war to be married, and their courtship continued through letters. Nancy worked as a resident artist and editor for the yearbook, was a rifle team sharpshooter, and recalls often riding her horse to college and tying her up at the old horse barn on campus. Before long, Lyle reported that he was having a hard time concentrating on flying, so Nancy wrote him and said she felt like they should be married before he was transferred overseas. Through a series of miracles, Lyle was able to get leave, which was unheard of at that time, and on October 9, 1944, they were married in the Logan Temple and were stationed in Seattle. Their time together was soon interrupted when Lyle narrowly escaped death as his plane went down in a terrible crash from which he spent 2 years convalescing. Nancy typically weathered this difficult storm, and 7 months after the accident, her twins Dwight and Doug were born. Over the next 26 years, 10 more children were joyfully welcomed. Nancy's fascination with books infused their home with a rich legacy of learning. And between chores, children would be strewn across couches, cuddled in corners, or in front of the fireplace, absorbed in a book. Somehow, even though money was tight, she always found a way to stretch her dollars to obtain yet another great book. Nancy's extraordinary mothering was honored when she became a finalist as Utah Mother of the Year in 1990. She saw the world as a palette, and everything to Nancy was fair game to become a work of art, from the smallest seed or twig to a gigantic Bowery ceiling. She left a trail of beauty everywhere she went. In spite of the demands of raising 12 children, she always found time for her art, co-founding and painting for the famous North Logan Pumpkin Walk for the rest of her life. When she was 58, with still children at home, she decided to return to USU to further her art studies. At age 90, she celebrated her birthday with an art show of hundreds of works, including illustrated children's books, etched glass doors, oil and watercolor paintings, pencil drawings, logo designs, wood carving, primary visual aids, murals, needlework, and sketches. She's also noted for illustrating and authoring several books, including the widely known Israelson Zoo. Most recently, she participated in publishing a 400-page volume, All My Love, Lyle, which is a compilation of those wartime love letters from her husband. Her artistry was not limited to canvas and glass, but could also be seen in her expansive, beautiful iris garden. For over 25 years, Nancy served as the ward primary chorister and is remembered by hundreds for her creative visual aids and unique songs. She frequently shared her powerful testimony of Jesus Christ with her primary children and her family throughout her life. She taught the children the value of work and play and to appreciate the beauty of nature. Not only did they work together gardening, canning, sewing, cleaning, and cooking, but we took every opportunity for adventure, camping, hunting, fishing, hiking, and horseback riding, as well as regular 50-mile expeditions into the Wind River Wilderness. Following Lyle's death in 2010, Nancy continued to lead the family with grace and direction and considered her posterity her greatest legacy. She is survived by her 12 children, Dwight, Doug, Jeannie Harrison, Laurie Ballum, Mark, Ned, John, Lila Geddes, Eve Jones, Richard, James, and Bonnie Erickson, 58 grandchildren, 132 great-grandchildren, and 3 great-great-grandchildren.
Well, I get the privilege of going first. I can't remember if I went last at Dad's, but if I did, that's why they made me go first this time. I don't normally get to do that after following 11 children and being the last. I'm used to going last. We were each given a strict 2-minute limit. How can we begin to touch the surface of our memories of our mother in that short of a time, but I'll try to scratch the surface. When I was growing up, my mom often told me that there was no doubt in her mind that even after 11 children, there was one more. At 47, that was a huge sacrifice to make. And once I was here, I think she realized why I was so persistent and insistent in coming. I've been that way ever since. I wasn't the easiest baby, as my siblings often tell me, and I wasn't one to sit still and take life as it came. I know my mom continued to sacrifice throughout the years, but as difficult as it would have been to raise a rambunctious child in her later years, I never once heard her complain. In fact, She would always tell me how grateful she was that I finished out her even dozen. She always made me feel, as I'm sure she did each one of my siblings, that I was her favorite. I was blessed to have had more one-on-one with my mom growing up than maybe some of the older siblings, as I was the last one at home. I remember watching her as she went back to school at USU to get a degree in art, and seeing her work on her paintings and drawing assignments. It was a great example to me of taking my school seriously and doing my very best. I remember watching her sew dresses for me and being amazed at her skill and her perfectionist attitude in everything she did. She would often ask my advice and my input on her drawings and her sewing, and I'd say, "Mom, it's great." And I think she kind of thought that I didn't get that perfectionist attitude that she had. She was so very kind and tender-hearted, even when she had to discipline us. We had a very strict rule about going to the canal, with an associated strict punishment to go along with it. When my brother and I broke that rule, I remember Mom having tears streaming down her face as she carried out our punishment, and I didn't break that rule ever again. My mother taught me to find beauty in everything. The sunsets, newly planted fields, flowers, trees, finding shapes in the clouds, and just about everything else in nature. She encouraged me to excel in anything I set out to do. She endured endless days of hearing me practice the flute and piano, traveled to many marching band competitions, and recitals. She encouraged me in my schooling, and she made me feel that I could achieve anything that I wanted to. When I got married, she told my husband in a very kind way that he'd have to be a good listener, because boy, do I like to talk. When I left Logan to move to the Midwest, I never thought I'd be able to live close to my parents again while they were still here. So it was a huge blessing when we were finally able to come back and spend her last 2 years with her. My children have been able to know and love her better than they could by just visiting once a year, and we wouldn't trade that for anything. One of the last things she said to me was, "I sure love you, Bonnie. You'll always be my baby." I am so grateful for my knowledge of our Heavenly Father's plan, and that we will once again be reunited with our dear mother. My missionary son sent me a quote by President Nelson this past week as he struggled with my mother's passing. It sums up the feelings I've had in the last few days. It says, "The only way to take sorrow out of death is to take love out of life. We sure have shared lots of love with you, Mom." And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Bonnie, I think you probably were the favorite. So Bonnie's right. I was worrying that by number 12, everybody would have said everything there was to say. So I'm glad that the younger ones get to go first today. I'm going to piggyback on a lot of the things that Bonnie said. One of the things that any of you that interacted with Mom would appreciate is that she could see beauty in anything. And as she got older and wasn't driving herself, it was my privilege to take her places in her car, and a lot of us did. And it never failed that we would be driving along and she would say, "Oh, James, look at the color of that sky," or, "Look at those trees," or, "My goodness, those are just amazing flowers. I've never seen them this beautiful." Every time, she had never seen them that beautiful. And it could be just as easily occur on a trip to the doctor as it could a drive up the canyon. And something I loved about my mother, and that I try to emulate She also was really good at seeing that same beauty in those around her. And any of you that interacted with her would understand that as well. One of the things I learned from my mother was to look for good in people. And it was often the case that I would be complaining to her about someone who had in some way wronged me or made my life difficult. And she would give me due diligence and express that it was unfortunate I was concerned. But she would almost invariably then say, well, you know, maybe they had a bad day today, or maybe there's something going on in their life that we don't know about. And boy, she was so good at giving people the benefit of the doubt. Another thing that I loved about my mother is that a simple utilitarian note could never do. It had to have a little drawing of some hearts, or she really was good at being whimsical and enjoying the magic in life. So as growing up as kids, we very much lived in the world of make-believe. We lived in the world of fairies and elves. And if you've been to the pumpkin walk, you have seen the whimsical side of my mother. And she just loved bringing joy to people in that way. Something that was really important to me that I learned from Mom was to be kind to animals. And I never saw her. Many of you perhaps bear scars from this dog of mine growing up. Her name was Pixie. And I like to say Pixie was a great dog. She just wasn't a very good dog. And Mom loved all of them. And I think it says a lot about us. It says a lot about a person is how they treat animals. A few more just bullet points that I learned from her. Embrace strangers. You were never a stranger very long in my mother's presence. And it didn't matter your background, and it didn't matter your political beliefs or the color of your skin or anything else about you. She would embrace you and you would immediately become someone that she loved and treasured. Another thing that I wrote down was find your own way. Never once did my mother say, well, James, I think you should do this as a career. She would listen to my ideas and she would validate them or potentially steer me away from the crazy ones. But she really allowed each of us to find our own way. Five more things. Hold hands. You're never not her little boy or girl. Differences of opinion, even in things you feel passionate about, are not a reason to feel that the other person is a bad person. Knowledge is power. Know a little bit about everything. Know a little bit about the world around you. In the last week of her life, I had the chance to spend a lot of time with Mom. And we were sitting late at night after dinner. We were sitting in her recliner. And we watched The Princess Bride, that great piece of cinema. And there's a quote in The Princess Bride that I thought I would end with, that when Wesley comes back and he meets Princess Buttercup again, and he says, why didn't you wait for me? I told you I would come. And she said, well, you were dead. And Wesley says, death cannot stop true love. All it can do is delay it a little. And that's how I feel about my mom. I think she will always love us. And I think my dad was tired of being delayed.
I think you're going to hear some common themes from all of us, it seems. What is a mother? To me, a mother is someone who nurtures, inspires, guides, teaches, influences, protects, corrects, and above all else, loves her offspring more than herself. My mother embodied all of these traits, raising each of her 12 children. And she never wavered in her example of how to live an honorable life. I really admire the way that she lived her life and set an example for everyone around her. I learned many things from my mom, small things and big things. In fact, she never stopped teaching, even if it was just through her example. From her, I learned to appreciate the value of all God's creations. Even a creepy spider was gently gathered and carried outside to safety. Mom instilled in me a love and appreciation for the beauty and diversity of nature. No two sunsets are the same. Every landscape is unique. And each creature has purpose, and life is sacred. She enjoyed creating her own version of nature through her many art projects and used many different mediums to do so. Mom also gave me a love for music. There were many varieties of music to be found in our home as I was growing up. She liked to play records, and there were all kinds of records: Broadway musicals, Mormon Tabernacle Choir, Ed Ames, several other tenors, and a variety of other records. And if one of those wasn't playing, then one or several of us was practicing an instrument, much to my dad's chagrin. Mom was an adventurer. She enjoyed a huge variety of activities. She loved attending sporting events. She went to arts performances, and in the day she rode horses and did a lot of gardening. At age 89, she attended a Major League Soccer game with me in Salt Lake City and seemed to have a great time. She didn't shy away from trying new activities, and she loved expanding her horizons even as she advanced in age. Of my lifetime of memories with my mother, some of my favorite are working with her and Dad at the cabin, a very special place to my parents and to the rest of us. There were always projects, large and small, to be done there, and for a time I was fortunate to go there with them several times a week as we worked to finish a large addition to help accommodate the growing family. The cabin property was given to her by her father, who received it from his father, who was the homesteader of the property. And she often made a point to honor them and their hard work and sacrifice to make it a place of gathering and peace for their posterity. Other memories include the smell of freshly baked bread or bottled fruit, a delicious home-cooked meal which often included produce from the garden, orchard, or even meat from the farm. In my younger years, we were dressed up, and with painted faces, we rode our horses, bicycles, ATVs, tractors, and trailers in the North Logan 24th of July parade. Thanksgiving at the cabin, even on years when the only access was by snowmobile or snowshoe, became a wonderful family tradition, as well as a Christmas time live nativity with children, grandchildren, and even great-great-grandchildren dressed in a variety of costumes which filled a couple of upstairs closets. Mom knew how to bring her large family together and gave us traditions to keep us close. I find it amazing and inspiring that 12 siblings can remain loving and harmonious through decades of time, and it's clear that Mom and Dad are the reasons for it. Their example will be felt through generations. I'm grateful to my mom for many things, most importantly, that she didn't decide that 9 children was enough. My mother is an amazing woman. She was loving and accepting of everyone who crossed her path. I never heard her gossip or say an unkind word about anyone. I'm grateful that her mortal trials are over and that she completed her mission on this earth and is now reunited with her ever-loving husband. I'm grateful for the example of a faithful life well lived. I do and will miss her until that glorious time when we are once again reunited. I love you, Mom.
I think my siblings and I had the best childhood that any child has ever had. We had the huge farm to play on. We had all kinds of animals to hang out and mess around with. And we always had a friend, a built-in, to do something with. And if that wasn't enough, there was the 13 Slaws next door that we could hang out with as well.
I'm sure my mom was a nervous wreck trying to keep us all alive every day. I know Irma Bombeck once said that a mother is a success if her child is still alive at age 18. And so I guess in that count, my mother was a huge success. So my sister Lila and I were very close in age, and we did a lot of things together. And one of the forbidden things was going down to the canal, of course, because mother was just deathly afraid one of us would drown in that canal. And one day, Lila and I had done something, and I can't remember if it was the canal or not, but mother was upset with us, and she felt like we should be punished. So in her sweet way, she took Lila and I inside, and she said, okay, you girls have to sit on this chair until I tell you it's time to get off. So Lila and I sat on the chair and looked at each other, and we just got off. And mother said, no, you have to sit on the chair, but we wouldn't stay in the chair. So she came up with an idea to keep us on the chair. She came over and told us she was going to tie us to the chair with invisible string. And so she wrapped that invisible string around both of us several times and tied a knot. And she said, okay, you have to sit here because now you're tied on with the string. So we sat there because we knew we were tied on. Mother would never tell us anything that wasn't true. So that's how we got our punishment. That's the kind of thing she did to punish us. Although I did get soap in my mouth one time for sassing her. Mother was a busy, busy mother of 12 kids. She taught me how to work hard, and I love to work because of her. I remember washing woodwork for 25 cents an hour, which is probably why the woodwork in my house isn't washed very often, because I hated that job. We picked apples for a bushel for 25 cents. We had to get up early in the summer at sunrise to weed the garden and to pick raspberries. We hauled hay, we fed the animals, we mowed the lawn, and we put up bushels and bushels and bushels of fruit every fall. And the interesting thing about that is that she made it fun. It was always fun to do stuff with mother. The thing I remember most about my mother is that she taught us to love the beauty around her. And I know all my siblings so far have said the same thing. If you look at the cabin or anywhere where she had anything to do with the cement, it's beautiful, because she would get beautiful leaves and make an imprint in the cement so that they are preserved and beautiful forever. In her house, there's a panel where there's leaves and butterflies preserved forever, and you can always know that she saw the beauty. There was always flowers on the table at her house. She always had a flower display. She was always finding little ways to make the house more beautiful. Up at the cabin, when you look at the pavilion, most people would see a ceiling, but mother saw a vision of a beautiful sky, and that's what she painted up at the pavilion. So in our family, she had a lot of mouths to feed, and so she had a huge garden. And we planted that garden every summer. And when I was a little kid, she would buy us a 1 cent package of mystery flower seeds from Burpee Catalog. And she gave us a little row in the garden, and we would go and plant the seeds. We didn't know what they were. And then she would help us weed until we could recognize what was a flower and what was a weed. And we learned the joy of gardening and being out of doors. And she, like some of my other siblings have said, she always was accepting and proud of us no matter what we did. Every accomplishment that we did, she thought was so wonderful. And whenever I hear the primary song, I often go walking. I think about my mother, and the last lines go, for if I love blossoms and meadows and walking, I learned how to love them, dear mother, from you.
So the thing that I got paid for was catching the mice in the closet in our bedroom, and I got paid 10 cents a mouse. So, Evie just reminded me of that. Here is a woman who raised 12 children. How does one dance that ballet and conduct that orchestra of life with so many precious little lives. They do it with efficiency, love, humor, creativity, and understanding, and a few tears behind the locked bathroom door. Mom taught us to work. We're all going to talk about that. And there's always a reward for working hard. Sometimes the reward was intrinsic, and sometimes it was something tangible, like a trip up to the top of the hill to get a soft serve ice cream cone. I remember chore charts every Saturday and little notes around the house reminding us what to do and what not to do. And I think there are still some notes in her house. I know there's some at the cabin. She didn't really have to discipline us much because we simply didn't want to disappoint Mother. And the worst thing she could say to us was, "I'm disappointed in you." And of course, she never said that to me, but I really felt sorry for my siblings when those words came their way. She taught us to use the fine china for regular meals, not just holidays or special occasions. And she taught respect for living things. I remember one time she sent Nellie downstairs to get something out of the freezer. And Nellie came up just a little bit horrified because she'd found this great big bird carefully tucked in between the orange juice and the frozen corn. And Mom just matter-of-factly explained that she had watched this bird take a kamikaze dive into the big plate glass window. And she felt sorry for it. So she went outside and retrieved it and stashed it in the freezer until she could find a time to capture its beauty on canvas. And growing up, we very often ate oatmeal or scrambled eggs for breakfast. So in recent years, when I would fix breakfast for her every day, I'd frequently make scrambled eggs, or I'd make oatmeal and jazz it up a little bit. And so you can imagine my surprise when she tactfully announced that she had never really appreciated scrambled eggs and oatmeal. She called it mush. And she said she felt that at the age of 90, she shouldn't have to eat it anymore. So I made pancakes and waffles. I feel very blessed to have been able to help her each morning for the past 8 years. During those times, she would tell me stories of her childhood, tales of her wild aunts and their escapades. She opened some closets with a few skeletons in them. Her high school years, she talked about her courtship with Dad, and she loved talking about her ideas for her next pumpkin walk creation. Last year, at the age of 93, she painted a gigantic scene of Captain Hook being chased by his nemesis, the crocodile. And she always did fastidious research whenever she painted anything. And I would see little tabs in the books of when she would paint animals and so forth, so that she made sure they were exactly correct. Anyway, she did not want the crocodile to appear too mean because she didn't want it to frighten the little kids at the pumpkin walk. The year before that, she painted an enormous 12-foot by 20-foot rendition of Mount Rushmore, pumpkin style, of course, and she aptly named that Mount Squashmore. She had a great sense of humor, like the time when we regretfully told her that she should no longer drive. So on the next April Fool's Day, some of us got a message from her saying that we needed to come and bail her out of jail because she had just gotten a hankering to get in the car and take a spin around the neighborhood, and she had been picked up and arrested for driving without a license. And for just a split second, we believed it. Mom was grateful for every single thing in her life, most of all her family and the gospel. Every day she said thank you. Many, many times for the tiniest of things. She would always tell me how lucky she was to have such wonderful children. Mom, I'm the lucky one to have such a wonderful mother. I love you, Mother.
Wow, look at the group. Well, I'd like to thank everyone for coming. A lot of you traveled from a great distance. Crookston family, Israelson family, neighbors. You know, my mother, I think possibly the good Lord looked at little Johnny who was being sent down here and thought, the poor kid doesn't have a chance if I don't send him to Nancy. So I came down and you know, the opening hymn, Teach Me All That I Must Do, is pretty much what our mother was. She taught us the right thing. She taught us the value of work along with my father. She taught us how to be responsible, love one another, and our family doesn't have any strife amongst the 12 of us, except maybe towards me. I haven't heard any of that, but she made do with what she had. She grew up on a farm with a father who was a great, renowned athlete. During the later part of her life, for many years, probably 30 years, she attended almost every Aggie basketball game and some football games. She had her own personal bishop at the basketball games, Vic Saunders. So she said, isn't it great that my bishop comes to sit by me at these games? And Vic would notice if I'd holler too loudly at the referee that I'd do a little bump like that, and that was Mother's elbow, still trying to tone me down. She taught us the pure love of Christ by her example. She had no enemies. She, James mentioned, she was always the hero of the underdog. And if we made an ill comment, well, I'm going to add one more thing. If we were criticizing something someone had done to one of us, she'd always end up saying, well, I'm sure he's a good person or she's a good person. As we go for a ride recently, I came back into the valley with her. She loved this valley. She'd say, this is the most beautiful place on earth. And she's been around the world. And she also put North Logan at the top of the list. It was a great place to grow up. My brother Doug and I talked about a home down where he lives. It looks just like the one up the street. We call it Darling's Corner. And it was a simple place. We knew each other. Mother adored her neighbors, starting with the Slaws, the Caldwells, and the Thompsons. They were very precious to her. But we had the benefit of having her as a mother. You know, by the time Ned and I were 12 and 13 years old, we also knew that we might have to go pick a willow and hand it to Mother if we were caught down in the canal. So Ned and I, we figured out one day a plan. And so we each took a Hardy Boys book with us down to the canal. And when we saw Mother standing there with her hand on her hip, we knew the retribution was coming, and quickly. So we stuffed those Hardy Boys books in our trousers, and Mother got the switch, and she wouldn't like us to mention this, but she finally admitted it. She went to town on Ned and I, and we just laughed, and the more we laughed, she finally put her hand on like that and went inside and disappeared for a while. So, she used to, the last 8 years, I've had the privilege of being there a few times a day, helping her. And Lila has been her primary caregiver, and so selfless, just like her mother, of helping her and getting her through things. And more over the last years, she would remind us of some of the stories of her youth and her cousins, her Crookston cousins, and she, and all the fun things that they do. She enjoyed family. She enjoyed her neighbors. She loved preparing for the pumpkin walk. And more over the last few years, after each reunion, or after each Christmas party, or after each Thanksgiving, it was the best ever. Each year it became better for her. And she became very thankful more and more the last few months. She's always called me Johnny, and I've allowed my sisters to do the same. About 4 months ago, she said, "Your name's my butler now," because I wouldn't let her get up and get a spoon or anything because it was difficult for her to move. And there's a special lady here, Prentha. You are my mother's best friend. We love you, and so does she. Thank you. One final thing I have to say is I dreaded when Mother and Dad would leave to go somewhere because I had Doug and Dwight and Mark, and invariably I knew that I was going head first down the clothes chute. And that happened every time. Mother taught us a lot of things, but we never really let them know what had happened to us while she was gone, because my brothers would find another way to get back at me. Mother taught us the true love of Christ. She taught us about the plan of salvation, of the pre-existence, about the promise of a resurrection and being together again. Let us each take something from Nancy's great example and incorporate it in our own lives. And remember what a loving lady she was. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
One quick announcement while they're coming up. Mother expressed a great desire to have a balloon release at her graveside service. So for family, we have 200 varied pink balloons in the door just to the right of this south exit. If you would each grab one on your way out and take it up with you, then I won't have to make a whole bunch of trips in the truck.
This lullaby was sung to Grandma Nancy by her mother, Glenna. To my head are guarding.
I think the second contingent came up a little more slowly than the first one did. And maybe we won't talk as long as the first group. There's so much to say about what we learned from Mother, and I'm just going to focus on one of 100 things. It started out kind of as a slave labor thing, where when Mark and John and I wanted to do something on Saturday, Mom would say, "You each have to weed 2 rows of corn before you can go and, you know, do the whatever the fun thing was." And it seemed like those rows were 100 feet long. They were probably 50 or 60. Dad planted them with the corn planter that he borrowed from the dairy. But we would go do it. And Mom loved to grow roses, and we'd go haul manure and put on them. We'd pull the grass out of them and get cut by the thorns. And the same with the irises that she loved to grow, that she would, every year she would look in her iris catalogs and often buy a new fancy iris that she would plant. The iris beds grew and grew, and she always had flowers for Memorial Day to put on 10 or 20 graves. But over time, somehow, maybe it was when she started paying us 10 cents a row to weed the corn, but I started to really enjoy the miracle of taking a dead little seed, as Eve alluded to, putting it in the ground and watching the miracle of growth. And over the years, I've always felt like I needed to grow a big garden. My corn is almost ripe. When I get back in California, I think I'm going to have a lot of ripe corn. And my brothers and sisters have planted orchards, and my mother was always tickled when I would bring her a box of citrus from California that we grew on our trees. In a way, as we plant the seeds and nurture the crops, I think a part of our mother lives on. And all I can say is thank you, Mom, for adding that beauty and those values to our life.
Like Ned says, being in the middle of a large family, we were always squeezed for attention. Today we're being squeezed for time, but that's fine. The younger ones deserve it. I just have one thing as well. From the time I was very young, my parents always showed affection. So Dad and Mom, whenever Dad would leave the house, he'd give my mother a kiss. And it wasn't a peck on the cheek. It was a real kiss. And when he came home, he also gave her a kiss. And I learned from a very young age that was really important, to show affection, to not only say it, but demonstrate it. And early on, whenever I'd leave the house, I always gave my mother a kiss, and she had to teach me early on that it wasn't the same kind of kiss that Dad gave her, that the kiss on the cheek was the right one. But I remembered from the time I was in kindergarten, I walked to school during grade school, and there was lots of times I was late for school because I'd get partway there and remember I hadn't given my mother a kiss, and I had this terrible feeling my day was not gonna go well if I didn't do that. So I'd go home, And there's several times where the bus had to wait for me as well, that because it was more important than leaving homework at home if I hadn't kissed my mother. And I don't remember any time where I saw my mother that I didn't give her a kiss when I came and left. And what my siblings don't realize is this was a great get out of jail card. And late, I got my share of the willow and my share of the soap in the mouth for not saying good words. But later in life, my mother would share with my siblings to their horror that I was such an easy child, I never gave her a minute of worry. So those kisses paid off. I was the last one When Mother was getting ready to go last week, Dwight was in China and I was in Vietnam, and Lila was in Europe, and we all scrambled to get back in time. And I was the last one to come home on Tuesday night. And I got in there, I gave my mother a kiss, I grabbed her hand, told her I was there, and she kind of winked her eyes and gave this little sigh, and I think the sigh was, well, it took you long enough, I've been waiting. But she kept track of that, and we all saw that. So I think the net is that Mother taught us love, and she didn't teach us love by saying things. She, as you've heard from everyone, she taught us by example and by displaying affection.
My mom was magic. I mean it, she really was magic. I learned it the first day, well, the first day I really knew she was magic was the day I learned to walk, which I can still remember. I saw her across the room with her arms outstretched and this look of encouragement on her face, and I felt that magic just fill me up, and I walked. Her magical hands could whip a pile of discarded dandelions into a magical crown to put on her heads, or it could nurse a little tiny baby bunny back to life with an eyedropper. She could get rid of a fever. She could turn our tears into smiles. And she could quiet a basket full of noisy magpies in our basement in the middle of the night. She could also make a feast out of what we grew in the garden that they've talked about. And I started to figure out how many magical meals she made for us. Somewhere in the range of 49,800 meals she cooked for her children. Not just a couple of children, but a whole army of children. Now, like all magical people, she was well acquainted with fairies. And they danced through her garden. And occasionally, they left letters for the lucky children who could find them. I noticed a lot of things about her that were magical, but none of them were more magical than being able to convince a house full of children that getting up before school to can 9 bushels of peaches was fun. But she did it. She could fly on her mare, on her Arabian mare Sheba. She could fly right across the foothills. And yet she could turn herself into a fairy queen with all of her jewels and go to the opera. Her most powerful magic, most of my siblings have talked about, that was her art. And whenever we saw her unwrap a piece of meat, we were excited because she'd take that white butcher paper, put it on the ironing board, and she would iron it. And when we saw that, we would stampede to the table because we knew she was about to create something wonderful. Or if she brought out her brushes or her markers, we knew we were about to see an ordinary thing transformed into something magical. And she always made sure that we had our own little pile of materials to draw right along with her. From the first time I walked, I followed my mom everywhere. I just wanted to be just exactly like her. And I remember as a toddler, I wanted more than anything else to help her with the laundry. Now, a non-magical mom would have just shooed me out of the way from being underfoot. She had a mountain of laundry to do every day. But my mom waved her magic wand, and there was this tiny little clothesline with tiny little clothespins, a tiny little iron and ironing board so I could iron right along with her. And as I hung up those little handkerchiefs and socks and anything tiny on my line, I felt her magic fill me up again. Throughout my life, she facilitated opportunities for me to learn and grow and to feel like I could accomplish, as my siblings have indicated. And the past few years, it has been a miracle to me to watch this woman go through such difficult challenges and difficult times and become unable to do some of the things that she loved to do so much. But I watched her accept that with grace and with appreciation. And Mom, I'm still trying to be just like you. Thank you, my dear, dear Mom, for giving us magic Your love was magic.
As you can see, I am not Jeannie. She has given me the assignment to speak in her behalf. And as a member of the family for the last 50 years, I had a unique perspective on Mother and Dad and all the brothers and sisters. One of the first things that impressed me when I first started going with Jeannie was when I would go to their house, and during mealtime, it was really organized chaos. Everybody was trying to grab what they could, and Laurie would run past the table and grab something on the way to someplace else. Rarely did she sit down and eat, and that's why she was always so slim and trim. But Jeannie had a unique partnership with her mother in that she was the oldest daughter, and so she had the opportunity basically to raise her brothers and sisters. And she was the enforcer. And one of the first things I found out was her nickname was Jeannie the Meanie. But I'm grateful for all the lessons that her mother taught Jeannie, because she's been a great mom. One of the things that Nancy loved best were children. And I remember the day she was released from being the primary chorister. She talked about how she cried. She loved all of the children. Now a few words from Jeannie. 2 minutes isn't time to express how much Mother meant to us all. She wasn't only an artist, but a musician, a cook, friend, author, a friend to so many people. I can't remember them all, the list goes on. We had a home with humor and smiles. A wise man once said, you don't quit laughing because you grow old because you quit laughing. My mom was never bored. She always had a big project going, usually on the kitchen table. And visitors, including family members, were encouraged to jump in to whatever was going on. My mom, Nancy, was beautiful inside and out. I'm grateful to have her for my mom. See you later.
First, I want to thank Lila, Eve, James, John, and others for setting such a great example the last months and years of taking care of a mother whose needs increased and abilities decreased somewhat. So thank you. And I'm very grateful to be a member of this family and proud. None of us are perfect. Some are more perfect than others. But I think that the lesson I've gleaned from being a member of this group is one of loving unconditionally. It's interesting how short the cycle of life is. Today, a death is insignificant, but it brings us all together to celebrate a beautiful life and remember each of us those significant things that our mother taught us, and it's interesting how different they were and yet how related. I've told a lot of people this. Maybe one of the more significant things I've learned from being a son to Nancy is to be loving and accepting of people. A few years ago, she has this hay field behind her house, and a few years ago, the hay had just been baled and was ready to haul into the barn, and she came home from church one morning and found out that the hay had been stolen. And I was disgusted to hear that and called her and talked to her about it, and she said, yeah, Doug, can you imagine someone stealing hay from a 92-year-old widow? And I thought, yeah, that's really bad. And then she said, and the lesson was, but you know, they probably needed it more than I did. So what do you say to that example? She had somewhat of a sense of humor, sometimes one that I didn't appreciate or one that I had to really work to understand. I remember when I was living in Minnesota and studying, she knew how much I loved horses, and she called one day and said, Doug, this is the most wonderful news. Our mare, we didn't even know she was pregnant, had two baby foals this morning. They're both males. She painted a great picture. They're both dark chestnuts with white stockings and a blaze in their face. And I said, that's so good. And I was just thrilled. And she hesitated. And then I knew she felt badly to tell me it was April Fool's Day. And, you know, I held that against her for a long time because it was so good, and then it disappeared. One time a few years ago, I was tying my shoelaces, and I looked down and I thought, Doug, you're tying your shoelaces backwards. And I thought about it and thought, how strange that is. And then I remembered, as a little kid, maybe 2 to 3 years old, when I was old enough to learn how to tie my shoes, I remember her kneeling on the floor in front of me and showing me how to tie a bow. And from my perspective, that's the way to do it. But if you think about from her side, it was backwards to me. So those little things are memorable and really sweet and appreciated and will enable her to live on in all of our lives. Finally, as I was sitting here with my wife, Karen, I thought, in this room are the people I love the very most. And I think that her legacy will live on with all of us. And I'm reminded of the scripture. I think she could say this today and she'd smile as she did. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course and I've kept the faith. Thank you, Mom. I love you. Doug and I are the oldest in the family, and growing up, we were expected to set a good example for all those who followed. And I'm surprised that everybody turned out okay. There were a lot of us. As Laurie pointed out, Mom had over 200 drug descendants. And growing up in North Logan, there were so many of us cousins. There were 68 first cousins. Is that right, John? 67 first cousins. And that's a big posterity. And then with all the rest of those are over 400 when my grandmother died. I remember hearing Dad one day, maybe 10 years before he died. And somebody said, oh, you know, there's sure a lot of Israelsons around. And he said, you know, there would have been a lot more of us, but the county started spraying for us in the 60s. So yeah, Mom did have a big task, and all my sisters have told how she never failed to be cheerful. But I remember once when I was a teenager, and there were 9 of us at home, going downstairs, and Mom was lying on the couch, pounding her fist, saying, I can't take it anymore. But she did, and three more at least. Esther and Olivia and Vanessa sang that lullaby today. It reminded me of something. They mentioned there was one more angel by the bed, and Mom really was an angel. And a few years ago, I wrote a poem called Angel, and I'm going to just finish by just reciting the last few lines of that. Most things are fleeting. They're here, then they're gone. Joys last but a moment, and life carries on. But families and friendships, relationships all, transcend every season from winter through fall. And when he considers these things of most worth, he thanks God in heaven for angels on earth. And Mom, you were an angel.
The smartest thing I ever did was linking the Balaam name to that of Israelson, Crookston, Ballantyne, and Stuart. I came into this marriage as a Dane. My family is Danish, but I soon learned that I had to become a Scot very quickly because Mother was so proud of her heritage. You notice I referred to her as Mother. I began to refer to her as Mother before Laurie and I were even married. We were engaged for 5 years, and I think it was inevitable that she would be my mother. I confused so many people by introducing her as my mother, not mother-in-law. I never felt that way. Mary, Queen of Scots, as she knew her death was approaching and would be very imminent, she wrote a song, both the words and the music, and gave it to her lady-in-waiting as a message to her people when she was gone. Mother asked me to sing this, so this is her message to you.
Mondays and evenings, volunteers would come to help make and paint backdrops. Even college students were helpful in making the event successful. Nancy always honored Ida and Wally and the wonderful idea that they had. They were always in a scene or on a display. At one time, there was thought by the city of maybe charging a little fee, and the money would go towards other things that the city needed, but everyone expressed that they had to be a place where all ages could come and have a good time without a cost. At another time, the local newspaper asked, which exhibit took first place? The reply is, all the exhibits took first place. They planned and their expenses were all done by volunteers who worked on their scenes. Nancy's artwork could have been in any art gallery or any prominent place, but that wasn't part of Nancy's dream. She wanted all ages to enjoy her art, and the pumpkin walk was an example of that dream. As a result, her and hundreds of volunteers over the years have helped thousands of people have been able to enjoy the event. People from Box Elder and Southern Idaho and other places have driven for this special occasion. And many of the volunteers in the past had said that they even saw Willard Scott was one of the official Pumpkin Walk t-shirts. And he said that it was an event, a voluntary response to the community on a special activity. Over the many years, hundreds of volunteers in the community have carried on this wonderful dream. And to all of you, thank you for your generosity and your contribution to our community activity. Nothing could happen without you. To show the effort, my wife had a wonderful experience. She brought her third grade class one year. It was cool. And one of your girls was there without a jacket. My wife shared her coat with a young girl. Then she looked up at my wife and she said, this must be the happiest place in all the world. We love you, Nancy and Lyle, for your generosity and love for all of us. And thanks to you.
I've had a chance to think back of my own personal interactions with Nancy and all the conversations that I've had with her. There was conversations in her cabin with scouts bouncing off the walls. There was times at the pumpkin walk that I was helping set up a set with Lyle and Nancy, and there's times she helped me with Cub Scouts as we stacked pumpkins and called them totem poles. I recall conversations that I've had with her as she invited me to come over and pick apples so I could use them for my family and make applesauce. I thought of conversations I had in her front room, and then she offered me a new illustrated book that she had done. And I think I have a full set of five that's part of my valued family collection. But as I think of those conversations, it becomes abundantly clear that what she prized more than anything else, her greatest love, her greatest passion, her greatest sense of accomplishment was her family. You may or may not be aware, there's a replica of Moses' tabernacle on 2100 North, and if you have a chance, you ought to go take the tour, but they've taken some professionals have tried to be historically accurate, and they've tried to be doctrinally accurate too, and it's a good learning experience to walk through. But as I was walking through and learning about that, and I was thinking about the 12 tribes of Israel, my mind turned to the Israelson family, and I thought about 12 children, and I thought about that huge posterity we just mentioned, about 193, I think that was, is that the right number? 205, wow, okay. Anyway, I thought, whoa, and I had this aha moment. I says, well, we have the 12 tribes of Israel, and we have the 12 tribes of the Israelsons. And I'm sure, for me, I thought, I must be the first person that's thought of this. And of course, I thought about it. I'm sure I'm about the 1,000th one. I'm sure it's an old pun or joke with the family, and I hope you can bear with me. But I thought it was fitting. There are some similarities. You have a proud heritage, something to be very proud of. And you have a wonderful, Lyle and Nancy has a wonderful posterity. And you were raised with a love of the gospel. You understood the gospel. You have a love and appreciation for family. Speaking of the gospel, I've been instructed as a member of the bishopric that my job is to teach a plan of salvation. And although I know that most of you here have a full understanding of the plan of salvation, I will take a few minutes and try and review that. Maybe not so much as a teaching and learning experience as maybe perhaps a source of comfort. In Hebrews, God is referred to as the Father of our spirits, and we literally are His children. We were created in His image, and we live the spirit children of our Heavenly Father. However, at this place in our pre-earth life, we cannot truly progress without the experience of mortality, without a physical body. The Scriptures teach us God's purpose, His work, and His glory is to enable each of us to enjoy all of His blessings. He has provided a perfect plan to accomplish this purpose. All of us understood and accepted this plan before we came to earth. All of us made the choice to come, to gain a body, to learn, grow, and develop. Under the direction of our Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ created this earth. In order to progress, each of us had to have this body and to be tested. While on earth, we don't remember this pre-earth life. Therefore, we must walk in faith. While we are here in mortality, we have experiences that bring us happiness as well as pain and sorrow. These experiences give us opportunities to learn and to grow, to distinguish good from evil, and to make good choices. We need God's help to choose the right and to repent of the mistakes we all make. Life on earth is an opportunity. It's a blessing. It's a gift. Our purpose in this life is to have joy and to prepare to return to God's presence. Our earthly experience results in two types of death. One death we experience when we come into this world. We experience this death because we're no longer in the presence of our Heavenly Father. We call this a spiritual death. While on this earth, we will make mistakes, and none of us is except the Savior is perfect. As stated in Romans, for all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. We are also told in the Scriptures that no unclean thing can enter the kingdom of God. There is nothing we can do alone to overcome spiritual death and return to our Heavenly Father. We'll also experience a second type of death, which is a separation of our body from our spirit. And like Nancy, we will experience this physical death. Nancy's spirit is no longer in her body, and perhaps the spirit can linger for a while. Perhaps her spirit is attending this funeral right now. I don't know. However, soon after death, our spirits go to the spirit world. Alma explains this state as follows. Now, concerning the state of the soul between the death and the resurrection, the spirit of all men, as soon as they are departed from this mortal body, whether they be good or evil, are taken home to the God who gave them life. The spirits of those who are righteous are received into a state of happiness, which is called paradise, a state of rest, a state of peace, where they shall rest from all their troubles and from all their care and sorrow. That is where Nancy is now, or soon will be. We believe it's a place where the gospel of Jesus Christ is shared to all. She no longer has her physical body, but she has her spirit, and she continues to live. She is still the conscious, thinking person we know of as Nancy Israelson. As Nancy goes through this transition, there will be those who have passed on before to greet her with open arms. I like to visualize Lyle there, open arms, greeting Nancy, and her parents standing behind her, waiting their turn, and then other loved ones joining her as well. We cannot overcome the effects of both physical and spiritual death by ourselves. We are helpless without the atonement of Jesus Christ. Without the atonement of Jesus Christ, we would not have the opportunity to be together again with our Heavenly Father. We remain a spirit only in the spirit world until we are resurrected. Resurrection is the joining of our physical and spiritual bodies. Just as Jesus Christ was resurrected, every person who has lived on earth will enjoy the blessings of being resurrected. Through the resurrection, all people become immortal. They will live forever. Immortality is a free gift given to all people, whether they're righteous or wicked. Eternal life, however, is not the same as immortality. Eternal life is a gift of God available to God's children through the atonement of Christ. It is exaltation, which means living with God forever. By virtue of Christ's suffering in Gethsemane, bleeding from every pore, dying on the cross, and then overcoming death through the power of the resurrection, Christ overcame all. He provided a path for us to take to return to live with our Heavenly Father. To fulfill the plan of salvation, Christ paid a penalty for our sins if we choose to accept it and repent. This is known as the atonement. As we rely on the atonement of Christ, He can help us to endure our trials, our sicknesses, and pain. We can be filled with joy, peace, and consolation. All that is unfair in the world can be made right through the atonement of Jesus Christ. Only through the gift of the atonement can we return and live with God. Nancy understood this gospel plan, and she lived a life that was congruent with that understanding. In closing, I feel the need to express how grateful I am to have had the opportunity to know Nancy and to be lifted by her cheerful and kind spirit. I am grateful for the life experience and knowledge that she shared with me. She is a wonderful wife and mother, and I'm grateful that there will come a time when Nancy will be reunited with all of us. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Prior to completing this meeting, I feel like I should announce that the dedication of the grave will be in the Logan Cemetery. And following that, the meal provided to the family will be at a different building. It'll be on 1550 East, 1900 North. And we'd like to thank the 3rd and 10th Ward for assisting with that. We'll conclude this meeting by singing hymn number 294, Love at Home, following which the closing prayer will be given by Doug Israelson.
Our Father in heaven, at the conclusion of this occasion in which we celebrate the life of Nancy Israelson and remember her love and example, may we resolve each to adopt into our own lives those things which she left us and taught us, and may we thus improve our own existence and memorialize her life. We thank thee for the opportunity to gather as friends, family, and loved ones, and ask that thy spirit and comfort will be with all those present. We say these things gratefully in Jesus' name. Amen.